Welcome to the continuation of our seminar on the Bible study method of the Jerusalem School of Synoptic Research. Let's begin with prayer. Blessed art thou, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who has brought us to this time and to this place, this eve of the beginning of the Sabbath, this eve of the beginning of the Jewish New Year. Lord, we bless you. We bless your people, Israel, and pray that as you're bringing them back to their homeland, you'll bring them back to yourself in all the fullness of who you are. Lord Jesus, we commit them, we commit ourselves to you, to your kingdom, to your ruling in our lives. And we ask that your Spirit might be with us as we open your word together in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
The last session that we had after earlier looking at some of the texts and reading them together as would be read by the theory of synoptic gospel relationships of our Jerusalem school, was to look at some of the other schools of thought. What has been taught about the relationship between Matthew, Mark, and Luke throughout the centuries? How Matthean priority was the dominant theory until the 1800s, when the notion came up of Markan priority, and how that has been almost totally dominant at the end of the previous century and throughout this century. Until the last half of this century, there have been serious challenges, both from folks who hold that Matthew is first and from some of us folks who hold that Luke is first. And we've talked also of who cares. We've got the three synoptic gospels and that fourth high-flown gospel of John. And there's even been a book written, Is There a Synoptic Problem? By Etta Linneman, with the answer, no. Each one had a variety of sources and wrote by the inspiration of God. And we mentioned how she had been a German high critic shredding the Gospels until the Holy Spirit got a hold of her and she became a converted Christian woman and is now emphasizing the one Gospel of Jesus Christ reflected through these four windows on Jesus. And yet some of us feel that she went from such a liberal extreme that perhaps she swung the pendulum a bit too far. And I've been presenting this theory of how helpful it can be as we understand the order being Luke, Mark, Matthew. Now, if somebody really gets excited about this, or if you know some young person that has a flair for linguistics, send them to Jerusalem. Because one of the students of Lindsay that I didn't yet mention is Dr. Randall Booth, who worked for years in southern Sudan as a Wycliffe Bible translator. Then with the United Bible Society in Nairobi, Kenya, in Chad. And now he's with the Institute of Holy Land Studies, also known now as the Jerusalem University College, where he's the dean. And he follows this way of Bible study. And just this fall, there is a Dr. Steve Notley that I have mentioned, wrote his doctoral thesis under David Flusser at the Hebrew University, who has been charged to set up a new department of New Testament studies where there's going to be an emphasis on the kind of thing that we've been doing together, an emphasis on Hebrew backgrounds, on Jewish culture. We'll be getting into that more tomorrow. And then also introduction to this way of reading Luke and Mark and Matthew. And for those of you who just joined us, here's the skeletal outline of that theory, something that every Bible scholar agrees who's really gotten into the Hebrew and Greek languages that there is an early Semitic substructure that the Greek of the Gospels is not a pure Greek. It's influenced by another languages, by Semitic syntax, and even the way the words are used. So that's not a problem. How much? That is a matter of difference. And we're among the forefront of those who are saying this is very important. And in the next lesson, we'll be talking about the importance of Hebrew. But then, where there is not agreement is just exactly how our writers have used the early material. And you remember Luke starts his gospel. Many people have put their hand to the task of compiling a narrative of things that have been, the events that have been fulfilled among us. So there's inspired scripture indicating that there are other reports out there before Luke is writing. And we're following this notion of Luke, Mark, Matthew being the order in which the Gospels were written. Now, this Lucan priority idea is not so maverick as may first appear, because it came on the scene at least 30 years before Markan priority, back in 1804. You have people in Germany, and from then on, for some period of years, writing about Lucan priority. Then in the 1830s, Markan priority came up, and we discussed in an earlier lesson what was the political and spiritual climate in Germany that led some Christians to feel that Markan priority was going to kind of save the situation, that you would give up to some extent on those infancy narratives of Matthew and Luke, and you'd kind of hang on to a historical core in the eyewitness of Peter as recorded by Mark. And we discussed how that process began of gradually giving up until finally scholars have backed off from the Gospel of Mark and end up with only some of the sayings of Jesus and the Gospel of Thomas that was translated from Greek into Coptic and exists in a 6th century after Christ copy as our oldest copy from down in Egypt, and scholars that are trying to reduce Christianity to nothing but ethical teachings and a certain gentlemanly behavior that can be learned and nothing about God who created the world and came to be Jesus Christ Emmanuel among us. And we discussed this. And so now I want to have a kind of a summary after we've discussed the Lindsay theory of Lucan priority. We've looked at the background of this other theory and some of its consequences. I'd like to go yet a little further. It's said of the New Testament scholar F.F. Bruce that he was asked, "What would you do differently?" He said, "I would spend much more time studying Hebrew backgrounds than Greek backgrounds." And of course it's important to study Greek, because that's the language of the oldest manuscripts that we have of the New Testament. And that's the target, as we've mentioned, the language into which that message, which was in Hebrew and in the Jewish culture, went out into the whole Mediterranean world. It was with perfect timing. The Jews were oppressed and looking for a savior. As far as the Jews were concerned, it was perfect timing. As far as the Romans, you had the Pax Romana, or Roman peace, throughout the whole Mediterranean world. And as far as the Greeks were concerned, you had their language as the English of those days, the international language. So you could travel any place without a passport, and you could be understood every place because you were in the Roman Empire and you're speaking the Greek language, and you had a message that came from hundreds of years of God revealing himself in the Jewish people, and there having many of them, not the majority of the people, but the book of Acts tells us myriads, tens of thousands did recognize Jesus as Messiah and accept him, and they began telling. So here we sit from who knows how many backgrounds, you know, interested in the God of Israel because of that outreach that began. So you do, yes, study the Greek world and the philosophy of the Greek world to understand that culture into which the message went, but the source is Hebrew. And I would like to turn to the theme of Jerusalem in the Gospels because it's fitting enough here on the Jewish New Year's Eve. And in New Zealand, would you believe that there's one denomination that is so upset about Jerusalem and about Zion, they have taken the reference to Zion out of every hymn in their hymnal? I don't think they've dared to go in and take Zion out of the scriptures, but at least, you know, get it out of the hymnal, because they're relating to it as something very particularistic, something relating to one people, something relating to a modern political ideology, and the word Zionismus, Zionism, with an ism at the end, is a new word, about 100 years old. Starts in the end of the 19th century in Germany with a bulletin that was called Selbst Emanzipation. You can even understand that in English. Self-emancipation, which is not a very biblical idea. And many of those early Zionists were anti-religious, as well as the religious Zionist who eventually cooperated with them to build the State of Israel. But there is this kind of uneasiness about the word Zion. It's too particular, it's too specific. And if one thinks of his Christianity as kind of a universal philosophy, it kind of grates on your nerves. And so for a group of Dutch theological students this summer in Jerusalem who wanted to know about Jerusalem in the Gospels, I took a look. And you know, it's such a delight now with these computer programs. You just type in Jerusalem and you get all the references in the whole Bible, and the printer just prints it all out to you, verses in context, and you can read and study. And what was I looking at? What kind of a Jerusalem was being talked about? Now, just a quickie test with the King James Version will give you about 811 references to Jerusalem, of which 141 are in the New Testament. And in the Gospels, every last one of them is physical Jerusalem, just simply the city Jerusalem. But out of the 811, the last five references speak of a Jerusalem which is above, or a heavenly Jerusalem, or a Jerusalem that's coming down, and they're not in the Gospels. But I would like to look at them with you. So let's turn to these references, starting with Galatians 4, Galatians chapter 4, verses 25 and 26. Because of 811 references, it's only the last five that speak of anything other than a physical Jerusalem. And just to let you know what's at stake, a couple months ago in Jerusalem, there was an all-day conference on Jerusalem in the liturgy. There was a Greek Orthodox speaker, a Roman Catholic speaker, a German Lutheran speaker, and a Jewish speaker. And the Greek Orthodox, you know, who have lived under Islam for hundreds and hundreds of years, and they just turned totally inward on themselves. They developed, because they weren't allowed to do social work and hardly to have theological school, sometimes not. And the whole concentration couldn't be an outreach. It was inward, it was on liturgy. They've got about 22 volumes of liturgy just to get them through one church year. And so the Greek Orthodox speaker said that when I enter into the liturgy, I'm entering into Jerusalem. I'm having a taste of heaven on this world, and in this life already, and just kind of a warmth and a zeal for the liturgy. Well, when they get out from that encrusted situation, you know, you get them Greek Orthodox on television in Chicago. They have social outreach. They have evangelistic outreach. So somehow the flame of the gospel stayed. But here was Jerusalem in the liturgy. I enter Jerusalem when I go into the sanctuary and I enter into the liturgy. Or the Roman Catholic speaker mentioning that, well, we have the 14 stations of the cross. And so we're like in Jerusalem and remembering what Jesus did in Jerusalem when we go into the sanctuary. The Lutheran speaker pointed out that in a Lutheran hymnal in Germany, as many as was something like 10-15% mentioned Jerusalem, but usually not the earthly Jerusalem, as over against a small, what you might call Christian Zionist hymnal that's used in the Feast of Tabernacles conference of the International Christian Embassy. She pointed out that some 25%, maybe 30%, and often literal physical Jerusalem. And the Jewish speaker said why we mention Jerusalem 10 to 15 times every day in our prayers. And as we bless God, we mention Jerusalem. And of course, every year at the end of the Passover, see you next year in Jerusalem. So look what a range we've got. And now let's look at this verse, Galatians chapter 4, verse 25. This is an allegory. The two women are two covenants. One is Mount Sinai, bearing children for slavery. She is Hagar. Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, and she corresponds to the present Jerusalem, for she is in slavery with her children. They're under the oppression of Roman rule at a time when Paul is writing this. But the Jerusalem above is free. Now, in both cases, he's talking about Jewish people. The Jerusalem above is free. She is our mother. And then he contrasts natural children with children of promise. And so we can ask, what is this Jerusalem above in contrast to the present Jerusalem? Then the next reference is in Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12. Verse 22. We'll start a little bit before. You have not come to what may be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom and a tempest and the sound of a trumpet and a voice whose words made the hearers entreat that no further messages be spoken to them, for they could not endure the order that was given. Even if a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I tremble with fear. But you have come to Mount Zion. Mount Zion with the temple and the sacrifices and the mercy of God being poured out on the people. And to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem. And to innumerable angels in festal gathering and the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven. And to a judge who is God of all and to the spirits of just men made perfect. And to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant and to the sprinkled blood that speaks more graciously than the blood of Abel. His blood that was spilt out of hatred, but cries out not for revenge, but for forgiveness. So a contrast between the terrifying giving of the message on Mount Sinai and Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem. And then I think I'll just read for you from the computer printout these verses from Revelation. Chapter 3, verse 12. He who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, and he will not go out from it anymore, and I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from God, and my new name. So names are going to be written on this
killer in the temple of God on those who become a part of God's kingdom. In Revelation 21, verse 2, I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down of heaven from God, made ready as a bride adorned for her husband. And in that same chapter, verse 10, 21 verse 10, and he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain, and he showed me the holy city Jerusalem coming down out of heaven from God. And there they are, the five references out of 811 that speak of any other Jerusalem than physical Jerusalem. And just think how church history has been impacted by these last five out of 811 references. How far removed we are from Jerusalem, so much so that the name Zion would be removed from Christian hymn books. The issue that we're facing is the issue of spiritualizing. And our New Testament teaches that the God of creation, the God of Israel, became incarnate. He came down into time and space at a specific place. And in Jesus spent many days in physical Jerusalem. And when Jesus left, the message was, you men of Galilee, why do you stand staring up into the sky, into the heavens? This same Jesus is coming back in like manner. And so many Christians have a hard time believing that Jesus is going to come back to Jerusalem. And a lot of Christians spiritualize the second coming. In fact, sometimes I tease liberal Christian friends, because if you think about church architecture, a lot of churches are oriented toward the east. And the idea is that you should imagine yourself sitting in Jerusalem, and if you look east, you're looking toward the Mount of Olives, in anticipation that the Lord Jesus is coming back to the Mount of Olives. Now, it's in some way we can't imagine, because everyone in the world is going to know it at the same time, you know, like lightning from the east to the west and these references that we have. But I say, your church architecture has got better theology than what you're preaching from the pulpit. You know, you're hardly hanging on to Jesus in his first coming. And you know that people who spiritualize the second coming are on the road to spiritualizing the first coming? Just around the corner, there's a Unitarian church. They've spiritualized the first coming. They don't need Jesus as the Son of God. They need him as a wonderful human teacher. And, you know, it's no wonder that a God is allowing the New Age. It's a judgment on a church that has gotten away from its underpinnings of a God who is revealing himself in history and whose Holy Spirit is available to indwell us. And if a church isn't emphasizing the historicity of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit that through him was, through his anointing, poured out on us all, well, then people go looking for spirituality somewhere else and for their inner lights and their inner divinity, and because we're not giving them the Word of God so that they would know where to look for it. And the New Age people, they get horrified from ideas that God would choose. You see, that there's something particular. You know, a specific person in a specific place, a Jewish man 2,000 years ago. And they even speak about Jews and Christians, this is a quote, that Jews and Christians, that is traditional Christians, should be transferred to a plane of existence other than the physical, which is a fancy way to say that we should get rid of them, because they are bad for society with their kind of tribal notions of particularism. This is how they talk. And you know, I come out of a Lutheran seminary, and I never knew what Luther said about Genesis chapter 12. When he was teaching his students, he said, look at these wonderful promises to the children of Abraham. Who are the children of Abraham? He said, the most natural thing to suppose as you're reading Genesis chapter 12, I will bless you and you will be a blessing and your name will be great, is that the Jews are the children of Abraham. He said, but if that were the case, we would expect to see them back in their own land. We would expect to see them have a state of their own.
And that's not what we see. We see them living among us, scattered and despised. They can't be the ones who are meant by the Scriptures. We are. And then he just continued the teaching of the Catholic Church, of which he was a member, that the church is Jerusalem, or heaven is Jerusalem, and we are the children of God, and we are. But it doesn't mean we have replaced the Jewish people. It doesn't mean that the Jews who believe in Jesus aren't that trunk into which we're grafted. So there are tremendous issues. Luther thought that he was living in the last days because the Turkish Muslims were attacking Vienna, Austria, and for him they were the Antichrist. And so if he's living in the last days, he didn't have time span left to let God do anything else with the Jews than what he was doing in the 16th century. And now we live in the 20th century. I like to tease fellow Lutherans, what if Father Luther had been alive today? But let's consider even these five references, the Jerusalem which is above, a heavenly Jerusalem, and then three references in Revelation to a Jerusalem that is coming down. Coming down to where? And that's what I'd like to look at with you now, to take a look at some passages that have to do with coming down. And again, the computer helped me out, and we won't turn to it, but I have it here, Exodus chapter 19, verse 11. No, the one I want is Exodus chapter 3. I know their sorrows, and I am come down to deliver. Coming down doesn't leave you up in some spacey heaven. It's God coming down into history and into time as a Savior. Back in the days of the Exodus already, I know their sorrows and am come down to deliver. And this is what we do, one of the methodologies that's used not only by the Jerusalem School of Synoptic Research, is look to Jesus' Bible when something seems a bit problematic to you. Find out where this expression is coming from. And of course, in the New Testament, we have no one has ascended into heaven but he who descended, the Son of Man. In other words, Jesus. And he was very real, you know, with us in this world. And it wasn't kind of an escape to somewhere else. He came down to be here in this real world. And this is the whole kingdom teaching, which I've been emphasizing as Lindsay's favorite theme, as Dr. Lindsay was the founder of this approach to the Gospels out of his translation work, not having any synoptic theory at all, except what he was taught at seminary, Mark and Priority, until he realized that's wrong through his translation work. And what I'd like to do with you is look at some references that might seem at first a bit far-fetched, and that has to do with the kingdom of heaven, this kingdom where the word heaven simply is another way of saying God without too lightly taking his name on your lips. And we're going to turn now to our synopsis that we've marked, page 137, where we have this passage that I think is going to help us understand what it means Jerusalem is coming down. And it's quite another thing than heaven being off at a distance, far away, nothing but a spiritual reality. And we're going to read the text in Luke. The law and the prophets were in effect until John came. But since then, the kingdom of God is proclaimed,
and everyone tries to enter it by force. And our style, you remember, is to look first at the Gospel of Luke, who usually has a more Hebraic character to his Greek. But we'll look across now to the parallel in Matthew. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven has suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John came.
Notice that just stylistically, there's this thing that's happening all the time, flip-flop. In Luke, it says law and the prophets first, and then the matter of force. And in Matthew, it has the kingdom of heaven suffering violence first, and then the law and the prophets. Just a little stylistic thing that we see going on over and over again. As they don't like to repeat each other exactly, they want to say it a little bit differently to kind of catch your attention. And not some great shakes theological difference, but the way of Jewish storytelling, catching people's interest. I actually don't even have an idea how much time has been spent by Christian scholars over the centuries on this verse. What in the world it means to take the kingdom, you know, violent men take it by force, or everyone tries to enter it by force, or the kingdom of heaven suffers violence. And you remember, part of our methodology is when you're reading a text, in fact, the first thing you do is translate it to Hebrew and see what you hit upon. And you hit on a Hebrew word, poretz. P-O-R-E-T-Z, if I transliterate it into English, poretz, which means to break forth, to burst forth. And then, once you're on a word like that, in trying to figure out, you know, what was Jesus, if I would sloganize what the Jerusalem school is about, we ask the question, what did Jesus say in Hebrew? Because of the kind of insights that can be gained. And we check out his Bible, you know, the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible, and you end up in the minor prophet Micah. Micah chapter 2. And verse 12, something that totally independent of any Christian interpretation has been considered a messianic prophecy by the Jewish teachers and rabbis of old already. There's a fascinating book. I think it's worth me making sure that you get the reference. Written by a man who lived many years in Jerusalem. Risto. Santala. Risto Santala. It's called The Messiah in the Old Testament in the Light of Rabbinical Writings. Then he has a second one, The Messiah in the New Testament in the Light of Rabbinical Writings, and his most recent one that's available here on our book table even is his book about Paul in the light of Paul's own rabbinical training. And he makes the point of this associative mind of the Jewish Bible exegetes, the Jewish Bible interpreters, to always be looking for associations. And it's incredible when you read this book how they are seeing Messiah almost under every passage. I mean, much more than what Christian interpreters have dared to apply to the Messiah is there in the Jewish world of interpretation. And let's listen to this passage now.
I will surely gather all of you, O Jacob. I will gather the remnant of Israel. I will set them together like sheep in a fold, like a flock in its pasture, a noisy multitude of men. He who opens the breach, haporetz, the one who breaks forth, will go up before them, and they will break through, the same word, and pass the gate, going out by it, and the king will pass on before them, the Lord at their head. And it's that special four-letter Hebrew word for the Lord God of Israel, not just the general generic word Elohim, but the one that's not pronounced. Instead, you say Adonai, Lord. Their king will go out before them, you know, God, the Lord God of Israel, at their head, the Lord at their head. And so they said, this is the King Messiah. Well, now what's the picture? You're in some kind of an entrapment, an enclosure, and you break forth out into freedom, and your king is going out ahead of you, opening the gate, bringing you out to where you're in a free area, and you're out in the pasture again, and you're out of the fold. Well, now, this, I propose, is what it means by the kingdom of heaven coming down. In the life of Jesus Christ, God is ruling perfectly. That's why his message when he starts out is, repent, the kingdom of God is here. Turn back to God. God's rule is here because it was perfectly present in his life. And his rule is breaking into the world. In Jesus Christ, God's rule has finally been exercised perfectly in this world. And when we ask for his Holy Spirit, then we are like, and now I'm not sure what is the better imagery, you know, like we're breaking out of the fold in which we have been entrapped, unable to live the way God wants us to live, and we're breaking forth out, open into freedom. Or it can be that God's power is breaking into our lives and taking over our lives. But on this kind of a background, we can understand what it means the kingdom of heaven is breaking forth. There's some question with the Greek verb there being passive or in a middle voice, or, and so that has caused the problem in our translations, as if something passively difficult, even bad, is happening to the kingdom of heaven. When the better imagery seems to be, as we ask, what was the Hebrew background of this, of the breaking forth of God's rule with the Lord Jesus as King Messiah ahead, breaking the way for us to break into the kingdom, or to let the kingdom's rule break into our lives. And here then is what I feel a scriptural answer to the notion that Jerusalem ought to be spiritualized, that heaven is somewhere else. It is also, there is the world to come. But in Jesus Christ, heaven has come down to earth. The power of heaven has broken into this world. And we can come under that kind of a rule. And so now, if I would try to summarize some of what we've learned in terms of our picture of Jesus, in terms of our picture of the Scriptures, and in terms of our picture of ourselves from this kind of Bible study, what we have in the Gospels is not the writings of, you know, three, four great individual religious geniuses, but people dedicated to Jesus Christ, whose sole aim is to present him to us. And there's the one Jesus Christ, and we have four windows into him. And thank God that we have this rich variety of different angles of personality who are presenting the one and same person. And I've shared with you before
But it was a very helpful comment to me of that Christian lawyer, Simon Greenleaf, who said, if I get four witnesses in court and they all agree, I know they're lying, because they sat down and they cooked up the story ahead of time. That's just not the way witness works. If they agree on the main points, that's where I feel absolutely confident. And if this one has this little angle and that angle, that's what's the ring of truth when it comes to how testimony can be evaluated. And we have this picture of God as Emmanuel, ruling, very physical in this life, heaven come down to earth. And we can be a part of it in this life already, and then anticipate that fullness of the kingdom. And then, in terms of the gospel writers, I have actually personally been very excited to get a sense that I'm getting to know these characters, and I have a special love for Mark. Difficult fellow that he is. And I want to set this up by reading a memorandum about the 12 disciples, and then as something that I found, and then a continuation that I've written about the four gospel writers. And hang on for this one, it's a bit tongue-in-cheek. It's from the Jordan Management Consultants, Jerusalem. A memorandum to Jesus, the son of Joseph, woodcrafter's shop, Nazareth. Subject, staff aptitude evaluation. Thank you for submitting the resumes of the 12 men you have picked for management positions in your new organization. All of them have now taken our battery of tests, and we have not only run the results through our computer, but we have also arranged personal interviews for each of them with our psychologist and vocational aptitude consultant. It's the staff opinion that most of your nominees are lacking in background, education, and vocational aptitude for the type of enterprise you are undertaking. They don't have the team concept. We would recommend that you continue your search for persons of experience in managerial ability and proven capability. Simon Peter is emotionally unstable and given to fits of temper. Andrew has absolutely no qualities of leadership. The two brothers, James and John, the sons of Zebedee, place personal interest above company loyalty. Thomas demonstrates a questioning attitude that would tend to undermine morale. We feel that it's our duty to tell you that Matthew has been blacklisted by the Greater Jerusalem Better Business Bureau. No collecting taxes for the Roman oppressors. James, the son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus definitely have radical leanings, and they both registered high on the manic depressive scale. One of the candidates, however, shows great potential. He's a man of ability and resourcefulness. He meets people well. He has a keen business mind. He has contact in high places. He is highly motivated, ambitious, and innovative. We recommend Judas Iscariot as your controller and right-hand man. All the other profiles are self-explanatory. And we wish you every success in your new venture. Now, that's the voice of the world, as over against the voice of the kingdom. And let me continue, tongue-in-cheek. As you remember that the classic symbols for the four evangelists are Matthew, a man, Mark, a lion, Luke, an ox, and John, an eagle. The memorandum continues, additionally, we have heard that you have plans to employ four scribes to record your activities. This appears to us to be a dangerous procedure that could cause confusion. We've found that Luke, when writing of his own activities, is quite capable of writing an excellent fluent Greek, but when he records speeches given in another language, he writes the most peculiar Greek that reflects the characteristics of that other language. He's like some steady ox just plowing, plodding along with the furrows beside him, and he just repeats what he hears and sees with a minimum of effort to unify his style into some kind of a fluent Greek throughout. Mark is worse. He flip-flops from sentence to sentence between fluent Greek and strange Greek, where he lets some strange syntax dominate his sentences. And when he reports the same speech as another writer, it seems that he just delights in reporting his own way, like some dramatic storyteller. He reverses word order, he uses synonyms, he reverses paragraph orders, anything to catch attention. He reminds like some devouring lion who removes half the story that he's trying to tell, and then he roars around the rest, dramatizing and expanding what's left. Matthew, at least, is a steady character. He's like some careful man who's doing his best with his materials. He's at least consistent. He maintains a high level of verbal identity to various parallel accounts, whoever they are. And additionally, he multiplies quotations from older documents to support the speeches and events that he's reporting. John is something else, like some high-flying eagle. He comes along with distant perspectives. Like some spacey philosopher or theologian, he starts way back at the most remote beginnings for settling down to his actual report. And considering the tremendous personality differences between these four, not to say personality quirks, we have a much better recommendation. Get yourself one tried, experienced, reputable writer, somebody with an elevated, elegant, unified style. I mean, after all, you want to give the impression of reliability, right? Well, then here's an even better recommendation. Don't entrust the job to even such a top writer. Stick around until he's finished, and then go over the entire text with him personally. Make sure he's got it just exactly the way you want it. And I want to dwell now on this point, just exactly the way you want it. Now, the world might have the notion that a text to be reliable should be kind of some one unified, neat, chronological account that can be followed, instead of accounts like we've been seeing with such differences and the chronological order basically there, but some of it's all out of whack. You want something unified, chronological, clear, not mysterious, something that, oh yeah, I can understand that, and then just put it on the shelf and reject it. See, the Bible is very different. I think the Bible is just exactly the way God wants it. It's not always so clear. It's got levels that are clear even for a child. So it's there, the clarity, if you want. But it's so deep, it's so rich, it's so full that the world's greatest genius hasn't cracked all of these different issues and how to interpret them. And the fact that he dares to use such a kaleidoscope of personalities in presenting the witness, I find fascinating, challenging, encouraging. I'm very encouraged by Mark. You know, if the Lord can use someone like Mark, you know, there's hope for all of us. You know, this young, bright fellow with his word associations and picking up references from all over the place, and if he reads it in the middle of Luke, moves it to the beginning of the Luke or vice versa. You know, and Paul got exasperated with him. I can understand Paul so well after having seen what Mark does with his text. I mean, try to imagine living with somebody like Mark. You know, say something, and the next moment he's flipped it right around. I mean, he's saying the same thing, but he just wants to be a little bit smart aleck and say it somewhat different and kind of make you sit up and take attention. And so we have looked at the facts of the New Testament reality. Fact. Now, this is not interpretation. Remember, we saw that the hundreds of manuscripts we have agree on 90% of the text. Some 10%, there's hundreds of little variants and some big ones. So that's the text. That's not interpretation. That's just the facts of the manuscripts that are out there. And then we've looked at the fact that as we compare these texts and we've done this color highlighting, we see Matthew having, on that very conservative, minimal way of highlighting that we've done, 50% of his words are identical in form and sequence to the parallel accounts, whether it's Matthew and Luke telling the same story, whether it's Matthew and Mark telling the same story, whether it's Matthew and Mark telling the same story and Luke also has the story, then Matthew is still 50% verbal identity with Mark's story. But what could possibly disturb us is that when they all three tell the story, only 16% of the words are identical in all three. But this is just facts. This isn't interpretation. This is statistical linguistics. Without even getting into statistical theory, it's just counting words and comparing them. So this is the reality. And I find a joy in sensing that God, in His providence, wanted us to have a text like this. And we've discussed before, what in the world would we do if we actually had Luke's original manuscript? You know, where would we put it? What would we do with it? And so here's this marvel of God's Word being communicated by the Holy Spirit through these different personalities, and the encouragement that we can get, you know, whatever kind of a funny personality you have, you know, the Holy Spirit will deign to use you. And you don't need to worry that you're different. There was one fellow on, I've been guiding for 30 years in Israel. I meet a lot of different kinds of people, and this one was very unusual. He was a real character. In fact, somebody said to him, you know, when God made you, He made one and threw away the mold, right? He said, no, wrong. He didn't even use a mold. Maybe you're like that, you know, but don't give up on yourself, you see, because this is what we learn from seeing the personalities of these gospel writers. And I find it so encouraging. And we have referred to that verse, you search the scriptures and you do rightly. You think that in them you have life. Now, what's Jesus' implication? You don't. But how did he continue? You refuse to come to me. You see, the Bible as the Word of God is pointing to God, is pointing to Jesus. And if you get stuck on the letter, and I think that's why God left us with the scriptures like he has, so we can't get stuck on the letter. 10% are variants, only 16% is verbal identity between the three gospel writers, without even taking John into account. But there's the unified witness to the one Jesus Christ through all these personalities. And after all, in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 22, it says the Holy Spirit is the guarantee. And we're even warned, the letter kills. You get too excited and you try to lean on the letter, it kills, because you're not leaning on this personal relationship to the Holy Spirit. You're trying to use something as a crutch. You know, and there's one denomination that might kind of lean on their tradition and on their one major leader, rather than on the Holy Spirit relationship to a living God. And Jesus warns us. The letter kills. It's the Spirit that gives life. So the letter points you, and if you get stuck on the letter and don't let it point you, you're in trouble. And so here we are then with Jesus as the Word, the Bible, the Word about the Word, the sermons as a Word about the Word about the Word, and theology as a Word about the Word about the Word about the Word. And I think then we got our priorities straight. And I feel there are simply great advantages to looking as ever carefully as we can at the actual facts, and then realizing what a wonderful thing it is that the Lord God has given us scriptures like these. We have historical texts, we have hundreds of manuscripts, we have such a clarity that He didn't just write it for us like in the instructions or even in the Bible, but lived it out among us, and we can let that kingdom of heaven that has come down on earth in Jesus Christ break into our lives. We can break into that kingdom. We can be a part of that place where God is ruling in this life already. And so, at least I think I've communicated some of my enthusiasm for what can be learned. And I have no doubt that the more we get into the truth of the text, the closer we are as we let it guide us to Jesus, so that we keep truth and spirit in balance. That's what Jesus said. God is spirit and truth. We need the truth of the statements that point us to Jesus, and we need the spirit that actually brings us to Him. And that concludes this section of a kind of review of what we've tried to show up until now. We'll be having further lessons going into the Hebrew linguistic world of Jesus and the Jewish cultural world of Jesus.